Hey, 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 everyone. Good afternoon. Here we are again with a wonderful, wonderful podcast and an amazing guest for Arise and Shine Stories of Triumph. So it's noon, and I believe most of you probably have risen. But if not, guess what? It's your business. So it's okay.
Yes.
As Tabitha Brown can say, it's your business. But one thing we want to do is we want to say thank you for joining us on today. As always, we pray that you will be blessed by all the conversation and all the nuggets and jewels that will be dropped on today. So I'm going to pass it to my lovely co-host, Tanya Blackwood, to introduce our guests on today. Tanya.
Yes, good afternoon, everybody. I'm so super excited to, well, for this episode. You know, Benicia and I always live anyway. I don't know about you, but we get so much from this every Saturday. You know, you could be in a position where you say, oh, well, I'm bringing a guest on. The people are going to learn so much, but we don't sit in that place because we always walk away from our episodes going, oh my.
It's true.
And you know, what about when she said, what about when he said, you know, and we don't ever want that feeling to go away. And we always want to keep it real with you guys. So today, I am going to keep it real. And I'm going to tell you that this amazing woman, ooh, Lady Karen Crockett Sherry. Now, Karen, do you keep Crockett Sherry on? Do I say both always?
No, current Sherry is fine.
All right. I just want to be politically correct. I don't want you to get in no trouble. So, Karen Sherry is a speaker, she is a coach. And I'm gonna tell you, I had a couple of coaching moments with her. Ooh, she, ooh, yes.
That's all you can say is whoop.
Yes. I love it. And she's an entrepreneur, an author, a collaborator. I think it could be fair to say that collaboration is just a natural extension of who she is because she's so free to share. And she may not call it an empire, but I feel like what she's built is an empire, and she's done it in the spirit of collaboration. That's why I have so much respect for her. She has been known as the woman, actually, this is one of her topics, and I'm gonna be in the front row in this class, how to put butts in the seats, how to raise funds for your event or your conference. And turning your connections into major collaborations. And I think one of the biggest proud moments for her is being a co-founder and director of Success Women's Conference. You know, regularly, folks, she regularly draws over 1,000 women in attendance. And she also has Power Up Summit, which is about powering up your life in the areas of finance, health, career, business. I mean, let me tell you, this bio, I could go on. I'm on, I think I'm on maybe line eight.
That's true, Tanya. That's
You
true.
know, when I say powerhouse, I'm gonna stop for a minute because the accolades list is insane. But let me tell you, I've spent some time with her. And Karen, you're about as real as they come. And I think that's why everybody's so drawn to you, your realness and your authenticity. And that's something that we hold in such high regard here. And then you have a love for community on top of it. So I'm going to stop because I want you to speak, but I just have to tell you, Benicia and I speak for both of us in saying that we are just so happy to have you here with us today.
And I am thrilled to be here. Thank you, Benicia and Tanya. I appreciate you inviting me to the show. I love what the show means and what y'all represent. And I love sharing and pouring into people's audience. So hopefully I can inspire somebody to take the leap, yes. especially now in the time that we're in. Thank you. I definitely enjoy everything that I do. As the co-founder and director of Success Women's Conference, I'm always looking to do something else as far as collaborating with other people yeah. and bringing other people to the stage, creating platforms for other people and bringing and allowing them to share their message with other people around the world. We were so fortunate in October to have over 17,000 people come through our 7-day conference. And so, you know, we were so excited and realized that, you know, there are a lot of people that are still struggling. And we knew that this time of the year was going to get even worse. Mm. So that's why we're doing Woman on Fire to help everybody start their year strong. And yes. January the 1st through the 3rd, we will kick off and allow people to really start their year right by making a plan. Mm-hmm. A lot of us don't have a plan when we start things. Mm-hmm. Set goals mm-hmm. and take action. Mm-hmm. So make sure you tune in to Woman on Fire.
Plan, set goals, and take action. Did y'all write that down?
She came off the gate with
with the juicy is one of my other favorite people. Dr. Cheryl would say that was juicy.
That was
yes.
juicy.
Yes, juicy and simple. So make notes.
And she will be there. So definitely, join us. We're looking for a great time.
Yes.
Yeah.
That lineup is crazy. I believe it. Yeah. I mean, I was scrolling through it. I said, well, maybe she'll let me come and take them to commercial or something in the midst of all of this. I mean,
we always brand. Welcome. Yes, yes, definitely. Well, y'all know me, as you said before, I do love planning and creating events and conferences. I have taken on as part of the thing that I do now is helping people create their own profitable event. Mm-hmm. So for many years, I've coached people behind the scenes and kind of just, you know, giving them pointers and talks
yes.
and help them. But now, you know, really and truly, I sit through and I actually help people develop their conference from beginning to end.
Wow.
So several of my clients will kick off early in the year with their conference. And then I have, of course, like you said, level up your profitability and visibility. So not sure what our theme would be this year, but we'll do level up and we will have power up. And then once again, Success Women's Conference, the big one will roll back around in September. So, yeah.
So amazing. I find like my insights is just leaping because you, even in a short time, you said so much. You know, I know we've been talking about on just different platforms, you know, individuals who are called, who are anointed, who God has gifted. Yet, like you said, you know, we can't just go on a hope, a prayer, and a scripture. We have to plan. We have to invest, you know, mm-hmm. into other coaches and other, you know, alternative right. methods that are going to help us be the best that God has created us to be. And that doesn't take away from anointing because you have a coach or you invest, you know, it's really propelling who God has created you to be. So with that being said, could you take us back a little bit and tell us, how did all of this even, you know, begin? Did you know from birth that you were just gifted in planning and collaborating? I myself and Tanya and everyone, we just want to know, how did all of this come about?
Well, you know, now if you're asking as a young person, I was quiet. I was actually the opposite. I was not trying to jump out front and all that stuff. I was the student in class looking to compete and get my grades. And, you know, I was that academic person. Mm-hmm. And as I was thinking about this and talking to somebody the other day, I said, you know, I keep forgetting that when I was in Germany and my husband was stationed over there, the chaplain that I worked with, he just had a lot of ideas. And he was the head chaplain, he was a lieutenant colonel. And mm-hmm. so he did not, he didn't let you rest, that was for sure. So even though I was just a secretary, he would plan events where, you know, these generals from around the country would come in and, you know, prayer breakfast and all those things. Then he did a children event. And I thought, you know, I guess that's where I probably got my true spark. And that was 30 years ago, because we, you know, I was responsible for making sure all those protocols were met and that everything was coordinated and everything was done. When you're dealing with those level of people, you have to make sure your stuff is in order. That's and right. So that being said, once I came back home doing our home care company, my husband and I, we're always givers. We believe that you give into your community. So that being said, you answer your community call. You know, there are things that come up that are not being addressed, right? And you can either sit and wait like everybody else, and or you can get up and do something about it. Thus is why we had our RIPE conference, Resource Information and Planning for the Elderly.
I've read that.
We did that for 6 months. And that came from a collaboration on a spur of the moment too. I took somebody a birthday gift and her and I became fast friends. And then from there, we just referred to each other, and then we eventually put the Resource Information and Planning Conference together. Over 600 people in attendance every year. And then Bless Girls Rock, my first lady, is something she wanted to do with some of the members in the church. And so that being said, over 450 women coming through that conference. We even had Dr. Cheryl come down 1 year for Blessed Girls Rock. So those kind of things already existed. I've been doing and creating events for over 15 plus years. And so the opportunity to create Success Women's Conference came from, you know, I had actually sat in meetings, been called and invited to meetings to talk about having a woman's conference, because we all know, you know, you can go to networking meetings, you can go to women's groups, you can go to the chamber stuff, all that, and you're still not getting fed, right?
That's
right. So there's a calling to actually feed the spirit and to feed your needs to take the next step. And many people find themselves trapped because they can't afford to take off a week and go be at a conference. They're not going to sacrifice their vacation to be at a conference for a week or whatever. They're just not going to do that, right? And here in Biloxi, Mississippi, it's like some of our people have a couple of jobs, right? So they just not going to take off like that. Right. So that being said, we wanted to host something. My partner and I were sitting and talking to each other, and we were like, you know what, why don't we just do it? Mm-hmm. And 6 to 9 months later, we had over 540 women that showed up in attendance. Mm-hmm. And when Dr. Cheryl Wood came through, I thought all of them had lost their mind.
We're just a little rowdy. Hey, EE squad. A little rowdy, but you know what?
And these were local women who probably had never seen Dr. Cheryl Wood before in their life. I had been following her online, and I saw her one time in person here, and a young lady had about 30 people in attendance, and she delivered it like she had 1,000 people.
Yes, every single time she opens her mouth. Always. Every single time.
And you know, I love her because she's real as well. She just delivers, she pours, and she is who she is. It's not, she doesn't change for somebody. And I think a lot of people like her because of that. And so that year we saw a shift. I told my partner, I said, I didn't know we had that many Christian women in the conference. And so the next year, Lisa Nichols came through.
Come on, now that's my girl here.
Oh, Lord. You know, we sold out of tickets. Her and Robin Roberts showed up.
Wow.
And we sold out of tickets before we knew we sold out of tickets. We had to literally make space And for the lunch room, we couldn't. We just had to start manipulating and moving things to make that work. And so we had over 1,100 people after the year before. We had about 700. So we went to about 1,100.
Wow.
And then in 2019, which was last year, we had over 25 states represented, over 100 speakers from around the country that flew in to the largest facility that we have here on the coast. And so it was just amazing to watch. And that was Dr. Yana Van Zandt that was there last year. But last month, we had Les Brown, we had Dr. Frazier, Sharon Lecter. I mean, it was just so many people that were there that, you know, were pouring into people. And then, of course, we always have what I call my features, who always deliver and always bring the information that you need and pouring into the people there. So success just came out of a need that we saw to inspire and empower people. And I want to say this about as far as coaches, because a lot of people got enlightened last year to, you know, why should they get a coach, right? And I say, deep down inside of you, before when you're born with gifts. You're born with talents. And a lot of times we sit on those gifts and talents. We allow a job to allow us to sit on those gifts and talents. And then we don't act on them. And they just sit there. I believe a coach is meant to help you bring those gifts out into the best that you have. A lot of times you're thinking, well, I just don't know how to make this happen. I just don't know how to take that and use that gift or to formulate it, to organize it. That's what a coach is for. And I can tell you this year, I often tell people two best things that happened to me this year. If you got a business, and especially if it's virtual, you need to get you a virtual assistant, some kind of help. And that was the best thing I did this year.
Yes.
Hiring my girl, Rita. And then the next thing was hiring me a coach. From the time I hired a coach, the first thing I looked at was, it's going to cost me this much money? Really? Right. You know, like, this really is an investment, right? I could buy a little car with this budget, right? Yes. And you're thinking, wow, you know, is this where I'm being led? I already looked at about six of them. Is this the right one, guy? And my husband looked at me and was like, and when are you going to take that leap? Okay, it's about time we stop looking at coaches, right? And the funny thing is, God lets you know that he's in it, because as soon as I finish, here you go. You got clients that already replaced the income that you spent, right? So for me, that's
all. Just have to step out. Yes.
You just have to walk in faith.
Yes. But
for those of you that think you have time, I'm going to tell the story that I tell a lot to remind people. And I actually told it recently, because there was one lady on the line and she had prophesied to me. And so, and she was talking about sitting on her gifts, right? And I was telling, and I, God, I wasn't there to prophesy. I was just there to talk. And, you know, and I was thinking, I'm going to receive mine, right? And walking mine. And so while she was talking about, I'm going to just watch all y'all take the next level. I said, oh, and God he said, okay, read her the scripture. So I started talking about Matthew 25:14-30, which is the scripture about where the master gives his three servants talents, right?
Talents.
He gives one 10, he gives one 5, he gives one. And the talents is actually money, but this is a parable. And so the master says, okay, go out basically and make me money. I'm going to be gone. And when I come back, you know, I'm going to bring me what you got. Right. So the first one comes back, when the master comes back, and of course he's like, master, you know, here's your money. Here's what I brought back. So he doubled the money. Right. And it was like, yes. My servant, you know, we're going to celebrate. This is what I'm talking about. You have paid my money. You doubled it. Okay, so the next one comes up. And I actually think, I want to say either he doubled it or made half, one of the two. But he brought it, and the master was like, yes, we're going to celebrate. We're going to celebrate as well. Thank you. Well done, my servant. Mm-hmm. And then comes the one with one talent.
Lord.
And he started explaining, Master, Jesus. You know, I know you're a harsh man. Mm-hmm. And I know I didn't want you mad because, you know, I didn't want to come back with nothing. Mm-hmm. So I buried it, right? And he was like, what? He said, get away from me, you evil servant.
Yes.
Evil, slothful man.
That's right.
Get away from me. Mm-hmm. And then he told him, basically he told him, summing it up, you will be punished. You will be cast out into the darkness with gnashing teeth. So you will never. So when you take that story and you look at you have gifts and talents
that he's given
inside of you, naturally given to you. Mm-hmm. And how dare you sit on those talents? And how dare you not share your stories? Yes. You know, if you have a book, if you have a book inside of you, you can at least share a chapter inside of an anthology. You know, if you are, as a person who is speaking, an author, a coach, you should be on somebody's stage, somebody's platform, somebody's podcast, sharing your story. Yes. It is your responsibility.
Yes.
God is going to get his one way or another. Now, one thing I don't want to be dealing with is an angry God, at least not at me. So therefore, do not sit on your gifts and talents. Okay. They sit there and you allow them to be crowded out. And when you say, oh, I got a job, I work, I got too much work. Well, guess what we got right now? We got COVID. And I often say that COVID was sent here to wake up his people, right? Because we have allowed everything else to become an excuse on why we're not doing what we're called to do, right?
Yes. And
so now time has been slowed down.
Yes.
I guarantee you, most of you are probably not out there running, you know, going here and there, because we are concerned. We don't know what we're dealing with, right? So therefore, you're at home. You have the computer. You should be doing something digitally. You should be speaking. You should be sharing. And you should be using your gifts. You got a business. You got many businesses inside of you. Create those multiple streams of revenue right now.
Yes.
Create your digital platform right now. There's two stories I think about out of my books, two different books. The one right now that Tony's going to be a part of, Make It Happen. And then the other one, Trailblazers Who Lead, which was released in July. The one in July, one of my good friends, Sabrina, I often tell her story because it just amazed me. She shows exactly why you should actually look and ask God to release your talents, to show you what they are. Because she was on a job making lots of money. She had the black card, the credit cards. She had the Mercedes. She had the house. She was living good, real good, right?
Yeah.
Everything's flowing. And then all of a sudden it's cut off, right? So what's your next step? So she actually started making art first. And then she started making handmade leather goods. Y'all, the woman makes leather purses, leather shoes. She makes leather jewelry and, you know, any kind of jewelry. She is so gifted. And I looked at her and I said, had you ever made anything before? She said, no, I've never.
How do you bottle that up? How do you bottle that up?
Hey, the name of her company is All Bottled Up. Hello. Yes, ma'am. That's the name of her company. That is the name of her company.
Look at God.
Jesus.
I'm telling you. And I'm like, and you know, I'm telling her, you know, God is calling you to, you know, she's still working some. I say, you know, you got all these artists here and they probably making more money than your job right now. You know, I always tell people, don't let the fear of not having insurance and stuff like that hold you and trap you and to where you're not even making your own income that comes straight from God. That's what entrepreneurship allows you to do. Your money is not dependent on the system. It's dependent on God. That's where it drops from. Okay. Yes. He will never forsake you. If you give your tithe and offering, hello. And you put him first as the head of your household, you will prosper. I can tell you that many days I look at, you know, I like to write my stuff down. I look back and say, you know, what was that money in? How did we pay the bills that month?
Come on.
You know, how did we get through that year? I'm telling you, he will provide. Yeah. And then this other lady that, and I think Tony was on the line the other day, when Judy Ambrosia James got on and she joined our Make It Happen book project. She talked about her story. She talked about how she went through a massive, there's a difference in case y'all don't know. When you have a stroke, there are, you know, strokes and then there are massive strokes.
Yes.
And so a lot of people don't make it through massive stroke, but she talks about how the rehab people, my background's in rehab as well, they rolled her down in her wheelchair as she was going to the dining room, and then they left her in the hallway and they told her, you know, you need to get to the dining room. We'll see you inside. And so she looked at them like, I ain't gonna get fed today.
Right.
Y'all gonna leave me out here like this? And so therefore eventually she made it in there.
Yeah.
And then she said, 3 days later, I was wheeling my wheelchair from my room on my own. And so I'm like, Jesus.
Yes.
And then she says, the one thing that she did, y'all, this woman had a master stroke and she has already captured the digital footprint of starting her own business from a saying, if you don't have a smile, borrow mine. So she built a business around that. Y'all, I'm like, hello, I gotta get that shirt, number one.
Yes.
And you are, here you are in your 60s after a massive stroke. You are already ahead of many people already because you got your own digital business.
Yes.
Y'all, that's a blessing.
That's powerful. Yes. That's so powerful.
Now, hello. Now, you talking about make it happen.
Yes.
That's somebody making it happen.
That's right. That's
somebody not taking no for an answer. Yes. That's somebody not lying down and saying, you know, I give up. I just can't. No. Yes. She's like, no, I will. Right?
And so
that is what I'm talking about.
Yes.
Walking in your gifts. Yes. Stop talking about faith. Start walking.
Yes.
And give God his testimonies. Jesus. Your stories are testimonies.
Yes.
So
share them.
And that, you know what I find so powerful in what you've shared is that, you know, you started off with the story about the talents, right? And the one that irritated the Lord so much is the one where it was buried.
Yes.
And where does 97% of unpursued gifts and dreams live?
Cemetery.
In the cemetery.
In the graveyard, y'all. In the
graveyard.
They get with them.
Mm-hmm. And people think that's an exaggeration. That's a true statistic.
No, it's not. But God's already told you. He said in Psalms, I think it's 18:16, basically, if you make rooms for your gifts, the world will make room for you. If you utilize your gifts, God will allow you to make money because the world is at your foot, is at your hand.
Yes.
When you do what God tells you to do, use your gifts. It's what he gave you to operate. And he didn't give you one. He didn't give you two. He gave you many. You're just sitting on them. You're just sitting on them and not taking it to the next level.
That's right. It's next level.
One thing that you said as I was doing a little research, you know, on you before the podcast, something you said was you must be invested and it can't be a hobby. Can we just dig a little deep in that, because I would imagine, you know, a hobby is something you choose to do. Like, you know, well, I want to do this today, so, you know, I will. If I don't, I won't. But can you just expound on that a little bit about, you know, really focusing on it, not as a hobby, the gift that God has given you?
Well, you know, even if you look at it from the coaching perspective, a lot of us, we go around and we're giving everything away free, right? Mm-hmm. You know, you come to me and get some knowledge and you ain't made no money from that. You just giving it away free. Mm-hmm. I told somebody the other day, mentor is another way of saying you want free coaching service, right? that's all you're doing.
That's good.
And so you have to be willing to take it and to believe in yourself enough to charge the fee. And y'all, I'm not talking about a couple of $100. Is your intellectual property only worth a couple of $100 when God has given it to you to deliver that message to somebody, to show somebody how to take their business or take their idea and take it to the next level? Y'all, many people, and I use cooks also as example, you got a gift. I'm like, look, if I could cook like that, I'd be in the kitchen all the time. And you know, I'd be taking pictures and putting it online and saying, you want this cake? Hey, $30, I'll mail it right to you. It is a business.
Yes.
Stop doing stuff for, oh, you know, I'm going to do this for the holidays. And these people turning out stuff that are better than what's in a restaurant. Yeah. I'm like, that is a hobby that you need to convert ASAP, yeah, right? Because right now, what is God showing you? You can use this great, wonderful World Wide Web to put out anything you're doing, right? Yes. I saw somebody, look at this. I saw online last week, somebody put a box online. It was one of those, one of them game box. Mm-hmm. Put it online. That box sold for $500. I said, now I'm gonna just tell y'all something. Mm-hmm. Now you know that's wrong. But the people did buy the box, and it did say it was a box. I'm going to tell you what that person gifting is. Hello, if that person is hustling, but you know what? People bought it. They were like, oh, maybe I need this box because I had the game, and now I want to sell it, and I want the box. You paid $500 for that box, y'all. But that person also is gifting in using the internet to work in their advantage as well. I'm saying, if you have a literal gift, whether it's talking, you know, getting on the stage and stuff like that. Yes. Now, I'm going to tell you as speakers, and I'm going to say this while I'm talking about this. Mm-hmm. As speakers right now, I do want to say this. Y'all, we're in a different time. I know everybody's thinking I should be paid every time I get on the stage. Mm-hmm. I should not have to pay to get on the stage. My voice needs to be heard. Yes, your voice does need to be heard. But sometimes you have to change with the movement, okay? And what's going on right now is those corporate companies are not paying corporate sponsorships like they used to. So virtual conferences, same conferences that you used to attend in person, are now making a shift. Because they got to, if they want to put their event on. As I told y'all before, we ain't going to have no more big parties around here, right? So that being said, you're going to share in the cost and helping bringing that to the bringing it to the worldwide internet, right? Mm-hmm. So you need to make sure that you are invested enough in your gift of speaking that you will actually pay to play. Sometimes I'm not saying that every time you get on the stage you should be paying, but you need to be willing to invest enough in your gift of speaking in order to be seen. Because I'm gonna tell you, I call 2021 a year of speaker for a reason. Because what's going to happen, if you can see people like Les Brown, Forbes Riley, Dr. Frazier, all these people online on a regular basis. They're on somebody's platform. And if they ain't on a platform, they're actually doing their own platform, right? and they're doing it, and they're not, they can't charge all the time because let's face it, you know, everybody can't pay. Now, do they still make money? Yes, they still make money. So don't be fooled. But that being said, it literally, this internet has leveled the playing field coming into 2021. Right. So guess what? You have an opportunity to be on stage with some of these people. You have an opportunity to be on the stage with Dr. Cheryl Wood. You have an opportunity to be on stages with people like Trevor Oz and all them people who are like, okay, I do this and I do normally get paid, but guess what? You know, times have changed. I'm doing both. Right, so you need to take advantage of that opportunity and invest in your gift of speaking by sometimes paying to play. And let me just say this. Pre-COVID, there were people already paying to play. And you know what? They actually were smart. I saw the genius in it. If you're on stage with somebody like Les Brown and you choose, you want to go to that conference and say, I want to speak right before Les Brown. Do you know how many people are going to be sitting there watching you?
Yes.
Because they waiting for Les Brown?
That's right.
I have seen people invest in themselves and turn around and get 3 to 5 times as much as they spent out their pocket that day off that conference. Right?
That's so good, Karen. It is an investment. And I'm going to tell you, because, you know, I don't make my age a big secret, but I'll say I'm old school when it comes to events. I've been in the game for a minute, but just having to shift now and take that mindset on as a coach and a speaker that's actually pursuing a career, because everybody want to put speaker after their name with a comma now, right? But when you are actually a speaker looking to speak, you need to put money in that. Mm-hmm. And the value of being on the same program or the same promo piece with that particular type of lineup, that is huge for your career. It's huge. And so you may put a few $100s into that, but the rewards from that far exceed, like you just said. And it is, a lot of times it's a fear factor that they use as an excuse not to pursue it. I know for me, it was old thinking. I'll be transparent. For me, it was, hold up, why am I paying you? You should be paying me. And then, you know, on your shoulder, you got the little, don't nobody know you, why they gonna pay for you? I mean, let's be real. So, you know, you put out, you invest a little bit, get to stand up with some of the greats, walk away with some wisdom, and build your portfolio. Right. Yes. That's win all the way around.
It is definitely, because when you go to those bigger stages, hello, we're going to ask you what stage you've been on. You know, it's like, and even if we don't ask you, trust me, we looking. Let me see what stage this person has been on, right? So especially if you're calling yourself a featured or a keynote speaker. And if you're coming to me talking about getting paid, then I'm definitely going to see what you got, how many butts are in the seats behind your name. What are you bringing to me? Because I've been told many times, you know, success, y'all are creating stages for people who ain't never been on the stage. And yes, that is part of our mission. We actually, Woman on Fire, the goal is to help people who have a voice, who already have a message. Maybe they've been, you know, in their backyard, as our good friend, Dr. Cheryl Wood said, you know, they in the pond and they need to get into the global ocean, right?
Yes.
So we set the stage for that, you know, but you got to understand it's opportunity. And that opportunity comes with a cost. Somebody paying for it. I certainly have paid for it. Last year, we raised over 200 plus thousand to put that event on and to bring people in and to put them on a stage. But the market has changed, y'all. And the shift is here. It is being forced upon us, whether we like it or not. And you're either going to choose to make the adjustment with the market, or you're going to be left behind when it comes to 2022. Because the people that are going to be picked up in 22 are going to be the relevant speakers.
Yes.
Okay? People relevant. Who are being seen. Yeah, and people don't think, I go to your Facebook site, your LinkedIn site. Let me see where they've been speaking. Oh, they ain't speaking nowhere. And they had a nurse to ask for $10,000. Right. You shouldn't be asking for nothing. Mm-hmm. You can't do that. Right. It's relevant. It's relevancy that's count. I don't care if they're celebrity. If you are a celebrity and you ain't spoken 3 to 5 years, you're not relevant. Right. You're just not. Wow. You're not going to put butts in my seat. You're not going to put enough butts that I want in my seat. Mm-hmm. I just told you I had 17,000 in October. So what are you bringing to the table? Bring it to the table. And then I want to see who you've been on stage with. You know, it's not enough that you just speak on the small stages. You need to get on the bigger stages. And some of them, I'm telling you, they're going to convert because they have no way to raise the money they've been raising before. So they're going to have to do that. And to be honest, some of them already have. And when I say people pre-COVID were already paying, I'm not talking about hundreds. I'm saying they were paying thousands to get on people's big stages.
Wow.
And so, and I've seen some of the people give testimony. One of our person that spoke at our conference, who was just coming up, but she was smart enough to see, well, it's a small investment and I can get on the bigger stage. And it was the first time we had ever done it. She offered, she stepped up Iman Washington, and her career, I've watched her since she left. She said, man, since I've spoken on the Success Woman stage, I have been getting booked. Okay. And so you have to be willing to keep that pattern inside of your getting booked to speak.
Well, Karen, can I ask you a personal question?
Yes, ma'am.
What in the world? Maybe it's not in this world. Maybe that's your answer. Where does this all, like, the audacity that you have, the courage, the boldness of character to lay foundations like this and say, this is how it has to be. Tell me about that meek, quiet girl in the back of the classroom, that transformation. Like, when did it happen? How did it happen? Can you remember how you felt when you took the mic for the first time? Talk to me about that, Karen, because I'm listening to you and I'm blown away that God has blessed you with so much wisdom and experience. And at the same time, I'm like, I want to hear about when she was meek. Like, I want to hear when, you know, the ground was shaking and she was scared to death. I want to... Come on. Well,
I can tell you right now, I've had a few of those. When I came back, first of all, I love connecting to people. That's one. So when I came back to the coast, I actually had to force myself out. Most people don't realize that, but, you know, attend events like some of the chamber events and things like that, and actually go out and be a part, be in different groups. I actually would choose to volunteer and participate. If you have a problem with struggling to get out, start volunteering and participating, and you will slowly find your voice, right? Because then you'll start saying, okay, well, I don't like that, or this should be done that way, or I can see this. And as I've grown through a lot of that and participating in a lot of things, in 2018 I dealt with a different issue and realizing that, you know, the scripture talking about the prophet isn't appreciated in his backyard.
Yes.
You know, I found myself doing something that God told me not to do for many years, which is don't submit that application. I told you not to submit it. And I submitted an application to be a part of something, and I was not chosen. And I was like, and it was like, oh, well, you were missing something. And I'm like, I think if I was a CEO of a casino or something, I'm sure that wouldn't have happened. But it wasn't about them.
Yeah.
It was about me because God had already told me.
Come on.
How in the world do I know when to submit the application every year without even looking? I'm right. Like, it's time for that application. And God's like, didn't I tell you not to put that application?
Right.
Okay. Yes. So when I put it in, think I'm a go do it with my friends because many of them had asked me to, let's do it together. Mm-hmm. You know, and then when I submitted it, I got pimp slap, right?
Mm-hmm. Right.
So literally I said, okay, that's fine. I'm gonna put in this other application that I've been looking at for the last 5 years versus 20, right?
Yeah.
So literally I put it in, and a few weeks later, I was sitting in one of my success meetings, and God was came across my email. Mm-hmm. You have been selected as one of the top 50 women in the state of Mississippi.
Yeah.
I said, yes, what I'm talking about. Yes. And I was like, oh my, I was like, really? Did that just happen? And so literally what God showed me is I told you.
Yes.
It's not where I want you.
Stay in your lane.
Okay.
Come on.
I'm not looking for you to be in the pond. Yeah. Right. But I was frustrated about that. And then the very next year, I got a call. Y'all, you know, I was literally looking crazy on this one. I said, I was in Jackson with my daughter, and, you know, which is about 3 hours from where I live. Anyway, I was visiting, and this call comes through, and the lady said, well, you don't know me, but I'm from the governor of Mississippi office, and I want to congratulate you on winning the Give Award. And I was like, you mean that award that I okay, yes, that award. Yeah, I wasn't even thinking about putting in for that. I was like, nah, you know, putting in, me and my friend was talking about it, we can nominate each other, all that kind of stuff. And so it was just a passing thought.
Right.
And they were like, she said, I know you shot. So, you know, I'm gonna basically let you digest it, but you need to be here in April, blah, blah, blah. And where the governor will present you your award. I was like,
look at God.
I said, hello.
Hello.
God was just showing me. You know, even this year when I was selected as the one of the vice presidents for the state of Mississippi Girl Scout Award, again, he was showing me, I want you on these boards. I want you even state, national, international.
Yes.
And so it made me realize, as frustrated, as well known as people like to say you are, oh, you know, everybody knows you. I'm like, whatever. I always tell people, everybody don't appreciate what you have.
That's right.
Everybody don't appreciate your gift. But sometimes that's because God doesn't have you there.
That's right.
Because he wants you sharing in the global ocean.
That's
he wants to push you where you're not comfortable, right?
Yes.
Where you're thinking, oh, I'm comfortable.
That's so good. That's so
I know everybody here. Right. Everybody knows me. At least I think everybody does, right? That's what you're thinking in your head. Mm-hmm. And God's like, exactly. That's why I don't need you there. Mm-hmm. I need you out in the ocean being a testimony for other people that are not in your backyard.
Right.
And so it was a push out in the comfort zone, out of my comfort zone. And then in 2019, right after success, I told my partners, I was frustrated. And I said, I think it has nothing to do with y'all. It has all to do with me. And God was showing me, he said, I need you to get a little more selfish, right?
Mm-hmm.
You need to start doing stuff that only has your name on it, right?
Right.
Because guess what? At the end of the day, I can make the final decisions.
Right.
And then I'm a team person. So me and my team that, you know, and they understand, okay, this is her product, but she's allowing us to have a voice in her product.
Right.
I don't have to go to nobody else and say, hey, that's what do you think? No.
Right.
I don't go, okay, I like that. Let's go with that. Right.
Yes.
So
yes.
He gave me Power Up Summit. He gave me that conference. And from that, I developed two conferences and a couple of little ones leading in. And so he gave me that. And trust me, the devil fought that conference real hard.
I bet.
We were supposed to be live in person in New Orleans. We had to convert after moving it a couple of times to a virtual conference in 10 days. Y'all, Jesus. When you're doing something and it's not in Zoom, that's a big thing. Trust me. And then the other thing was trailblazers who lead. You know, and I resisted that hard. That was just like, I am not a writer, you know, and God was like, bitch, you gonna write this? And I'm like, okay. And then he put the right person in place to kick me out in the front, because she kept saying, what are you waiting on? You know, she said, you got people that are connected to you. I'm like, and she was like, you shouldn't have a problem. You can do it. You know, basically, launch that anthology, put it out there, you'll get the response. And I'm like, mm-mm. And finally, I just said, okay, I'm gonna do it. And sure enough, as I did it, people had reached out to me. I never met them before in my life. But from that, these women, you know, we have grown together, y'all.
Yeah,
I've watched them grown. They're speaking more now, they're booking themselves. They've been on podcasts.
That's kingdom building, Karen. Yes. That's kingdom building. Yes. And what advice would you give to people that are considering doing an anthology that have a story to tell, that have people that have multiple stories to tell? How do you even go down that road? What's your advice to them?
So an anthology is a chapter in your life. It's not a book. Right? It's not your full story. You know, most of you, and I watched one of my friends on Stevie, actually is the one
Dr. Stevie.
Yeah, and she said, you know, I want you to write down all your ideas, all your things that you think you have as a story. And then one of them posted, and she looked and she had 40 things. Wow. And when you think about it, most of you have so many stories inside of you that you can share with the public. And then there are stories that you can change and tweak and share with the public in the global ocean. Somebody is waiting to hear that story. Your story is definitely not your story. Right. It's meant to touch somebody else's life.
Yeah.
So think about it. Most anthologies, they ask for anywhere from 650 words to 1,000. There are so many people right now that are waking up and saying, this is your time. You can share your story. So I tell people, jump out there and get a part of an anthology. And I suggest in year 2020 that you consider doing at least 2 to 3 different anthologies. Be a part. And yes, it does cost money. Okay. I'm just going to be honest with you. Some of y'all looking for the free. I'm just like, stop that. They have payment plans. I mean, I've watched Dr. Cheryl do hers for years. She's made hers reasonable and easy to do. I have my own. You know, I realized when I started with mine, it was not for me in the first place. God wanted me to help other people put their story out to the global ocean. I'm a visibility person. Yeah. So my thing is, I want to not just help you share your story, because that book becomes like a business card. It's a calling card. Mm-hmm. When you sit down, somebody reads that book. Oh, and they don't even know you, but they know you because they read a chapter in your life.
Yes.
Right. Yeah. They don't know all of you, but they get a little piece of you. Right.
Yeah.
And so that being said, you need visibility from that. And I like to promote my people by taking them on podcasts like yours and on radio shows, Facebook, put them on magazines and stuff like that. I like to do that because I believe that's what you need in order to increase your visibility, because visibility leads to what? You got visibility, credibility, leads to profitability, y'all. And that's what you need to be pushing for.
Yes.
Sharing your story in the book allows you that opportunity. So that being said, share your story. There are too many of us out here have anthologies. And for those of you on the flip side who are smart enough to lead those stories, then right. you can make an income from that, right?
Right.
So that is the other side, but you got to get out there. You got to share your story.
Yeah, Sandy Sanders says in the feed, she loved what you talked about your story not being your story. And Dr. Cheryl says that all the time. Mm-hmm. Your story is not right. for you.
Yes.
It's not she for does. You. Venetia, she what does. Were you going to say?
I was just going to ask her, you know, and you've mentioned this, that, you know, we're in COVID, and although there are some restrictions in different spheres, there's also lots of opportunities. And so one thing that Laura has been dealing with me on is, let's think about, it's a mind shift, right? Let's think about what you have as opposed to what you don't have.
Right.
And so what would you tell someone who may be in a financial situation, right? They may have lost their job, and maybe they don't have those funds to invest at that level. What are some practical things that people can do to try to sharpen the gifts that God has given them? Because I think what I've seen sometimes, and even been guilty of, you know, prior to having your mind renewed, is you just think that you have this gift. Well, that's great. And you have an anointing. That's great. But we still have a responsibility, like the talents, to sharpen that no matter what level you're on. So what practical advice could you give someone in that situation?
And so you're talking about as far as bringing their gift to the forefront and utilizing it to make an income.
Yeah.
So if you pay attention to the internet, the one thing I say about digital business is that the cost to do it is a lot lower than actual in-person.
Okay.
You
know,
you don't have the storefront. I have a building. Trust me. I call it, I say, you know, I own it now, but that's a debt for a long time while you paying it off, right?
Right?
So we need to start thinking of things differently. Mm-hmm. We always think of stuff as, and they make you think this way, right? You know, you got a house, as you know, and all this stuff. I said, it's a debt until you pay it off. It ain't
that's
yours
right.
until you pay it off.
It still belongs to the bank. Yeah,
exactly. And if you're not doing right, they can come and steal, not the bank, but you got all them threes. I'm going to call them the threes. We hate to say their name online. But anyway, that being said, look, with the digital platform, there is a lot of times a low income cost. Even when people are doing t-shirts and stuff online now, there are companies like, you don't have to spend nothing out your pocket.
Wow.
You can link up with us and then we will actually create the product, send you 50%, we keep 50%,
wow.
right? Mm-hmm. Think about it. You know, as I was talking about people that cook and stuff, right? You know, if you think about it right, you start with the lower end foods that you got to create, right?
Mm-hmm.
Look, if you're on food stamps, hey, everybody been down that road, yeah. right? At some point in your life, you're going to hit a struggle. Mm-hmm. Look, even if you're on food stamps, you take the little stamps, take a little piece of that to the side and say, you know what? I'm going to take this money and turn this into more money, right? So that I can create an income from that, you know, because it's not meant for you to be poor. We keep acting like it's meant for us to be poor, but it's because you're not walking in your gifts.
Right.
When you walk in something that's given to you naturally and you're walking in that gift, I'm telling you, when you do that, it will make money for you.
It
will make money for you. The problem is with most people, they're looking at somebody else's plate and they're trying to do what the other person doing.
Yes.
It ain't your gift. It ain't your gift. Do what's called to you. You not sure what that is? Spend some time with the Lord and he will let you know what
that's
your gift is. Sometimes, you know.
What I love about
that's so good.
The essence of who you are, to me, it just brought back what you are all about is collaboration.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm in a group of women, right? Mm-hmm. And we all have different talents.
Mm-hmm.
So if we come together, you know, and I say, well, you know, I'm good at this and you're good at, well, how can I help you? How can you help me? And we push each other forward.
Mm-hmm.
It just pushes the kingdom forward. It helps you move in your giftings. It can cut down on costs. Not saying that we're not, you know, I believe in sewing and paying my friends and things of that nature. But like you said, when you're in a different season, you have to know when to and when not to, you know? Mm-hmm. So I have friends that pour into me that don't necessarily charge me monetary, right? But our giftings complement our gifts and help push us forward. And so I love what you stand for, which is collaboration. And the last thing that I just want to ask you is, what qualities would you say that you actually walk in to help you or would help someone to be open to being collaborative? Because In our culture, right, that isn't something that is very, that is embraced easily. You know, you thinking, oh, the other person's going to do better than me, go farther than me, make more money than me. So what qualities would you say, you know, one has to have in order to be able to embrace other people's gift, to be their cheerleader and want to see everyone win?
Well, first of all, that crab in the bucket mentality got to go.
Yeah. Right?
Because you can't ask other people to help your people when you ain't doing it. Right. So, sometimes just getting online and supporting people, it's the quality of giving, right? It's the natural desire to want somebody to do better. Right. And just support each other. Somebody got a book. $20 ain't gonna hurt you. I'm sorry.
Right.
It's just not. You can pop that $20. Somebody got a t-shirt. Yeah. Oh, I could do that. Mm-hmm. Let me do that and buy a couple other ones, right? That ain't gonna hurt you. Y'all, you thinking about money wrong. When you give, you will receive.
Yes,
you know, my favorite quote, and has always been my favorite quote, is that you reap what you sow.
Yes,
you do. If you ain't sowing nothing, y'all, if every time you do something, there's money attached to it or something like that, there's got to be something back and forth. You ain't sowing. You got to give. You got to give with no attachments, and it will come back to you.
That is
God. Look,
that is so good.
It's just like the tithe and offering. You give 10%, God gives back 100-fold. If you don't believe me, try it and ask him for the return. He does not lie. So that in itself, give and you shall receive is number one. Y'all, you also need to look at your relationships. Listen to your people, right? Try to learn something about your people that you connect. And don't just swim in your own circle.
That's right.
You need to get outside of your circle. It's okay to connect and collaborate with people you don't know. Mm-hmm. And if you're looking, look, as Black folks, y'all, I'm just calling what it is for y'all, you know, support each other. Stop worrying about what the other person got on their plate. Mm-hmm. Hello? It's not going to help you to look at their plate. The Bible already says you don't covet your brother's stuff.
You better come on.
Out of order. You want to block your blessings? Start doing that.
Watch
your stuff be cut off. You're gonna be like, oh, okay, Lord, I see.
So good.
Don't do that. And then the other thing is, y'all, that you do need to look at factors when you're in relationships. If you take it to a business side, now you do need to look at some serious things when you're partnering with somebody, because there are things about a person that's going to be a telltale sign. Mm-hmm. You know, you need to be with people that have emotional intelligence,
high emotional intelligence.
Yes. That means they have empathy. That means they're self-aware. That means they are self-motivated.
Yes.
You don't have to kick them in the butt to get stuff done.
That's right.
Right? And then they understand when you're going through stuff, really understand. They understand what other people who they don't even know are going through. Those people are people that become great partners.
Yes.
But sometimes you can get mixed in and you have to start to leave. So one thing God's been telling me, you know, and literally, y'all been telling me, look at your relationships, right? He literally is telling me, look at your relationships, because that can be a blocker. People don't know that, but who you're connected to can cut off your stuff.
Yes.
Hello. So you really need to look at it. When God says look at it, he means you need to look at it. Mm-hmm. And I'm telling you, when he starts saying, I'm like, okay, if he dropping this nugget all the time, he telling me I got to change the course.
Absolutely. You know, that's
I don't
so good.
Believe in blocking my blessings, right?
No. Nobody.
You know, no. So, and know this, for those of y'all who think, you know, I should be at a certain place already in life, right? And I know we've been trained to think in the 30s and 40s, you at your peak, right? You at your peak, you should be doing it. Well, I'm going to tell you what Dr. Frazier said, and it made so much
sense. Oh, I love Dr. Frazier.
The time has changed. The time has changed. Mm. He said, look, y'all, when you in your 70 now, you're in your peak. When you are in your 80s, you at your best. Look at some of the presidents, right? Yeah. And then in addition to that, when you're in your 60s, you just getting started.
Come on.
But so for me, in my 50s, look, I'm
We babies, girl.
So I was like,
she's a newborn, Karen. She's a newbie.
You know what I'm saying? So you don't feel like, and then God has been showing me the one thing in COVID, you know, he shows you this is your time. And for those of y'all who are not storing up, I want y'all to think about Joseph, right? Now, y'all need to see COVID for the other side that it could be, right? Yeah. Now, you need to be storing up.
Yes.
Just store up your acorns, right? Mm-hmm. Don't be out there spending so frivolously that it don't even make sense.
Right.
It is time to be prepared. Mm-hmm. Because when God shows you things, he also is preparing you for things.
Yes.
So good.
Right? And in the time when Joseph came in and came into the country, remember, that was 7 years of famine. You don't know where we're headed, but we know that the Bible already speaks. Things ain't going to get great as far as that's concerned. So be prepared.
That's good.
Start to store up. Look at your finances. Look, COVID has shrunk us down. So guess what you ain't doing? You ain't spending as much money as you were spending before, right? So don't be online shopping for Louis Vuittons and all that kind of stuff. Where are you going to take it to in the first place? Hello? You know? So just saying, so think about it. Like I said, COVID has been a mighty interesting thing for me. Yes. And for a lot of us Christians, we have seen double, triple, you know, multiple, more money. I've heard many of them say, I made more money in COVID than I ever made in my business before.
Yes.
So come on, y'all, challenge yourself.
Yes.
Make multiple stream of revenues. Mm-hmm. It is a rule of thumb. Mm-hmm. Seven different streams of revenue. Should it be similar? Yes. If you are a speaker, you should be coaching, you know, and they're inside of coaching. There are already at least four levels, consultant, VIP, half a day, group, and then your online courses. That's just in coaching, right?
Yes.
Authors, you hear Sherwood say all the time, look, anthologies bring me money. And it gives people opportunity to share their story.
Yes.
That's the stream of revenue, y'all. Magazines, right?
Yes.
You digital. Everything's digital now. You can get into the magazine side. I can go on and on. Create your own event. Now, I say that because, number one, it's what I do. I teach people how to create their own event. So you know you can go to CoachKern.com and find and connect.
Yes, CoachKern.com.
Inside of that, I teach people how to make money from that.
Mm-hmm.
You don't need to be having big parties. Women, stop getting together and being all happy online and all that kind of stuff. And then you look at your bottom line and you say, oh my God, I didn't make any money.
Yes.
No, you didn't, because you didn't set it up right. You should have hired a specialist like me, and I can show you your pocket's going to be full.
Yes, ma'am.
Hello. I'm just telling
yes,
you,
ma'am.
Change the mindset.
You know what?
Get into it with that.
That and I want to piggyback on that. Look, this has just been extraordinary because you've shared so much. And then, you know, the similarities of, like Dr. Cheryl sat down and gave us a list of 25 individual revenue generating activities mm-hmm. that we should be doing because we took part in her anthology. Right. She gave us a list. So that's on my list of things to do for 2021, mm-hmm. right? Because if you're smart, you're going to crack the whip on that. But mm-hmm. something you said earlier that I've been blessed to be exposed to Lady Cindy Trim, and in some of her coaching, she talked to us about those relationship bands. And you just mentioned that. And it's so important because how she explained it is that we take an audit and an inventory of other things in our life, but we never go back to look at the different bands and levels that we have people on in our life.
Yeah.
And it takes courage, right? Because especially if you're a people pleaser, you don't want this one upset with you and that one upset with you. That's another coaching lesson altogether. Mm-hmm. You got to get rid of that. But everybody needs to do an audit because you have some people that are on the colleague band that don't need to be on the colleague relationship band. They probably need to be gone. Mm-hmm. And, you know, then you have some people that are on your close friend band that they don't need to be there, truth be told. They're not cheering for you, trying to take you down. No, so you need to do an audit. I did one at the end of last year. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it was a little shocking mm-hmm. and it hurt a lot.
Yeah.
But when I got to the other side of it, I was better for it.
Yeah.
You know, and I think that's so important.
Yeah.
Because that circle, those yeah. relationships around you will build you.
Let me tell y'all something. When I had my daughter's wedding, and she got married a few years ago, and I had to sit down and make a list. And she's like, well, Mom, you know, I'm looking at my dollars, right? So I'm like, I can't afford to have everybody here. And then I started assessing the relationships.
Right.
Who is going to be mad that I didn't put them on the list? Mm-hmm. And who is, it's just like I tell people with events and how much money you spend. Mm-hmm. You need to decide who has to be there.
Yeah.
Who would you like to have there? And, you know, this is a dream person or yeah. something like that.
Right.
So that being said, you know, you have to do that relationship. Who should be in your circle? Who is contributing? Yes. One of my good friends, and CIO of Success Women's Conference Mentors Network, Dr. Yolanda Jerry, she told me, and I think she's going to speak at this on Success. I've often laughed at her because she can purge a Facebook. You know, you only get 5,000 people. So at some point you're going to cap out.
Right.
And she's purging people. And it made me realize, women, we got to purge.
Yes.
We got to purge. I'm telling y'all, that's why I told you earlier, God has been literally got me up one morning, mm-hmm. Got me up and told me, dump all these organizations. Like, get rid of them. I told you. Now I'm telling you now, you need to serve notice and be done.
That's a great right? word. Purge.
And then I walk to the computer and jump on. One of my good friends, Kathy Amos, was hosting a vision thing, and they prophesied over me. And guess what they were prophesizing over? Relationships.
Yeah.
Right? And I was like, Lord, when you start going to the computer, talking to people, and this subject keeps coming up, I'm like, trust me, y'all. It is God. It ain't, they're just being used to speak to you and to tell you what you need to do. And yes, you need to look at who is really behind you.
Yes.
Your inner circle is your tight circle.
Yes.
If that person ain't cheering for you, if that person ain't willing to go to bat for you, if that person ain't willing to say, you know what, she's a great person.
Mm-hmm.
He needs to be here. You know, if that person ain't on your team, it's time to purge.
Yes.
It is time to purge. Yes. And part of, and the other thing is, y'all need to learn to say no. Hello. Come on now, women. You know what? I say this to men, because one thing I notice about my husband, he can say a no, right, real yes. quick, right? Yes. Now, I'm not doing that, but mm-hmm. as women, we want to cater.
Yes.
We want to, we don't
but like let me see what I can do. Let me
And it's so like, what you
over. Move that over.
Yeah. yeah. No. That's why. That is part of the reason why you don't have nothing.
Come on.
They're blocking your blessings. Yes. I'm telling you, some people in your circle right now, they hoping to block your blessing.
Yes.
So if that's you, if that's the person you are in the circle, you about to be kicked out if the person is waking
Come
up.
On.
I'm yes. just telling you now. Yes. So it is time Jesus. To purge these people who ain't for you.
Yes,
and
man.
I'm telling y'all, God will ride you. So I'm telling you, if he's sending you signals, he's going to ride you till you do it. Sometimes he'll just shut it down.
Yes, he will.
He'll be like, you will be forced to let go of these people who are keeping you from doing what you're called to do. Right?
Yes.
So don't keep those women in your circle. You know, whoever they are, men, you as well. I'm sure you got some you need to purge.
Yeah.
Purge them out. Yeah. Purge them out. Let them go.
Yes, ma'am.
This is what I love about the purge, and you alluded to it earlier, is one thing that God had to show me, and it was an aha, life-changing moment. He said, you can't be more loyal to people than you are to me. Mm. Hello?
And that's part of the purge.
Be more loyal than you are to me. So when you are a people pleaser and when you're always saying yes, and when you're so concerned about what everybody else is saying, you're allowing God to take a back seat. And I had to learn that.
Mm-hmm.
And so when you really want to
please God, so
when you really hear his voice and you don't hearken mm-hmm. and obey, then now guess what? You've made that person an idol. Because anybody would choose over God or anything you would choose over God, you've put them in his stead. Yeah. And when he told me that, that was the beginning of breaking that people-pleasing thing. And another thing I just feel led to say is, you know, it's not about time. So you could be friends with somebody for 60 years, but if God said that the season is up, then the season is up. Because what I've recognized is that when people have done things for us and, you know, have weathered the different storms with us, God had them there for a season and a reason. Some are for a lifetime, some are not. But we can't, when someone does something good for you, you do say thank you. I'm one of the most humble, grateful people that you would meet. However, one thing the Lord had to tell me is that that's still me.
Yes.
The good thing, right, comes from me. So what we do is we begin to feel obligated to these individuals, right? But no, our obligation is to God. And so just like Tanya and Karen have said on today, really at the end of the day, I really believe 2021, God is really, not just 2021, but our lives in general, what he wants is obedience by any means necessary and at any cost, period.
Yes. And let me tell y'all something. Sometimes it ain't about you. Sometimes.
That's one of my favorites. It's not about you.
Sometimes he is talking to that person.
Yes,
that's right.
You know the word, but ain't living the word.
Come on.
You, when you walk in, look, when you walk in a manipulative spirit, right? Let's call it what it is.
Jesus.
A manipulative person, no matter what, they will do something to make you feel like I need to keep this person in my life. I need to hold on to this person because they'll do something to make you think, oh, she's not a bad person. She's not this, that, and this. But that is not a spirit of God.
Even
if it's something good, if you did it to manipulate that person, you ain't operating in his spirit,
right?
So sometimes he's using you to open that person up and say, you need to change.
That's so good.
You need to look at what you're doing.
Yes.
So I'm going to remove it. And yes, they may be good people that can help you, but guess what? you need to be looking to me. You ain't looking at me, so I'm gonna remove these people out.
Come
so
on.
You can see who you are. That's right. Sometimes it ain't about you.
They're a crutch, is what I hear you saying. Yeah. Some people are crutches in our lives. Yes. And not that we do it intentionally or even consciously, you know. I remember when my mom passed away again, like, okay, so what we gonna do? So she gone, but I'm still here because all those lead back to Jesus. So what we gonna do? What you gonna do? It doesn't matter what it is, what you lose. But one thing I love about God, and you said it earlier about, you know, his provision. This has been so amazing. You have all my wheels spinning. And we know is that, you know, God doesn't lie. He has never taken something out of my life and haven't replaced it with something better and bigger if I allow it. Because we also have to be in a space where we can receive it, you know, and we can move. So even learning to make room, you know, for what God is.
Oh, you just took that right out of my mouth, Benicia.
Oh, my goodness. Yes. All I'm saying is you just said it. You know, because we don't obey, we are blocking our blessings, the bigger blessing. So when he say, look, you got to do this, and you resist it, trust me, you missing out on opportunity. You probably set on something thinking, nah, I should have done this years ago. Because you were sitting on that blessing. You were blocking that blessing. And, you know, I often think, too, y'all got to remember some people. Sometimes you have people in your life, they're just like parasites, you know? They just bleed you dry.
Yes, they suck the life right out of you.
Yeah, look at those people. Like I said, assess the situation.
Make sure that
you're not the only one giving, and there's no returns coming in your direction. If you have relationships like that, it's not a relationship.
It's
really not. It's a one-way street, and you have to let go. Yes. You just have to be willing to say, no, I'm done. It's okay. Look, we can be free. I learned, look, from that wedding, I learned. I see you got people here in the inner circle. You got people in the outer circle, you know, outer friends. And then you got associates. Okay?
Yes, ma'am.
And then there's the people that you know.
Yes. Right?
So... sometimes they got to move to those outer circles.
Yes.
Right? There ain't no hating. You know, you good, you love them because you're a God-given person. But at the same time, they're not meant to be in that inner circle where you're sharing all the time. Yes. Right?
That's so true.
Ooh, that's so
true. Look, don't cast your pearls before swans. Swans, y'all.
Because we were just saying that
swans up in there.
Yes.
Hey, get them out so that you only cast them your vision before people who appreciate it and allow you to grow it and to walk. So look at that. Some of these things could be blocking you from you saying, okay, I don't have enough money to do this and that. You don't need a lot of money to do a lot of things now because of the internet, but you can have the wrong people surrounding you and keeping you from doing that.
Jesus.
So you really do need to look at purging.
So good. Woo wee. I'm about to call you Dr. Cherry.
I must need to go get this doctor title.
I know.
Not everybody keeps saying doctor. I'm like, Lord, is that another thing you telling me?
I know it. Well, you walking in it. So, you know, I shared with Benicia. I'm like, I want to be Dr. Blackwood. She's like, well, it's going to come to you how God wants it to come to you, right?
Yes.
But I need y'all to know to go to CoachKaren.com.
Yeah.
I need you to go. She's on Twitter too, at Karen Cherry, PRN. She hasn't mentioned, but she has successfully built a company that's been in existence for 23 years plus, I think a few months, right? You can find her on Facebook at Karen Cherry. And oh my goodness, this has been extraordinary.
Oh my God. This,
you have to promise us that you're going to come back.
Oh yeah, I'm gonna bring some of my authors.
That's what I'm saying.
Well, I'm gonna bring my authors. Look, y'all, I still have a few slots for Make It Happen. So if you want to join the project like Tony here and share out your story, get out there, y'all. Don't sit on that. Don't block that blessing, because when you're not sharing your story, sharing stories are testimonies. And if you're not giving testimonies, you're not doing what God has asked you to do.
Yes.
Okay. So it is time for you to do that. Be a part of somebody's anthology. But if you want to be a part of mine, go to coachkern.com/make it happen. And if you want to create your own event and you want to be profitable in 2021, go to coachkern.com and schedule a discovery session as well. So I have totally enjoyed this. Y'all have truly been a blessing to me.
I love it. Thank you. You guys make sure that you share this, even if it's over. Definitely put it in your timeline. Share it with your friends, because there were so many fruit and morsels dropped that can be passed on to others. Thank you again so much, Karen, for coming through.
Yes.
And I'll see you soon, because I can't wait to get started on my chapter. So we have to
talk. We meet on Tuesday. Yes.
I will see you soon. Take care.